Hey everyone, and welcome to another skill capped guide. Whether you're new to WoW PvP or have been getting into it for a while now, we found that most players lack the knowledge they need to be able to play against every class. One of the most common issues is that players don't have a good grasp of what the classes they don't play are able to do. And more specifically, they just don't know what the different buffs that appear under enemy unit frames mean. So if you're someone that's struggling to figure out what's going on and how you should respond to the different buffs that appear on enemy players, this video is the perfect tool for you to broaden your knowledge and start dealing with enemy cooldowns more effectively. This video is also the perfect addition to our add-on course and omnibar guide, as you'll now have a much easier time understanding what cooldowns you should be looking to track. We also won't be including things like crowd control in this video, and we'll just be sticking to buffs. So if you're interested in building an even stronger understanding of each class, you'll want to head on over to skillcaps.com/wow, where we've got a collection of knowing your enemy guides that will instantly help you achieve the level of knowledge the best players in the world have for handling every class. Alongside our knowing your enemy course, you'll find plenty of other content, including weekly releases of arena commentaries, of which we've currently got hundreds on the site, to help you learn from some of the best players in the world by watching as they explain their decision making in real time. There's no faster way to start improving and achieving your goals. So again, if you're interested, head on over to skillcaps.com/wow and sign up today. Link in the description. To kick things off, let's start with one of the most popular classes right now, Paladins. The first buff we'll be looking at is Avenging Wrath. Now, this simply provides them with a boost to their damage, healing, and critical strike chance. What's important to recognize here is that red paladins will pair this with Divine Toll, meaning that whenever they use Avenging Wrath, they're always going to do insane damage. It's for that reason you never want to just sit in a stun and not trade defensive cooldowns. As for Holy Paladins, they're basically able to heal any damage no matter how crazy it is while Avenging Wrath is up. So you shouldn't bother trying to overcommit for a kill if a Holy Paladin has wings up. Now this might seem simple enough, and most of you are probably already aware of Avenging Wrath and how it works. However, what complicates this ability is the fact that both Red and Holy Paladins are able to proc Avenging Wrath outside of their 2-minute window. This is because of Aura of Reckoning and Awakening. When it comes to dealing with Aura of Reckoning, it is at least telegraphed, and you can prepare for an upcoming wings proc by checking how many stacks they have. Some classes like Warriors also don't crit very often, which means you can even avoid doing damage for a small window if you see their Aura of Reckoning is going to drop soon. As for Awakening with Holy Paladins, there's not much you can do as it simply procs randomly whenever they use Word of Glory. The main issue is that these procs make it difficult to track Avenging Wrath with Omnibar, as the cooldown will restart whenever the paladin gets a proc. So just try to sync something like your PvP trinket with Avenging Wrath so that you're always prepared to handle it and can never get caught off guard. Next, Divine Shield is probably the most iconic ability for paladins that most of you already know, so we'll keep this one simple. It's just an immunity with a 5-minute cooldown that can be removed by Shattering Throw and Mass Dispel. What's important to know though is that the cooldown is reduced by Unbreakable Spirit, which you can expect most paladins to play with, and it brings it down to a 3.5-minute cooldown. Paladins also have access to a handful of blessings, including Blessing of Protection, Sacrifice, and Freedom. Blessing of Protection provides paladins with an immunity to physical damage, so you'll want to have your team offensively dispel it if possible. What's great to know is that some melee can still deal damage through BOP. Paladins can deal holy damage, Venthyr Warriors can condemn, Assassination Rogues can envenom, and so on. Although most melee have a physical interrupt, except for Shamans and DKs who can still interrupt through BOP, so make sure not to waste your interrupt into BOP. It can also be used while the paladin is already in a physical stun, so always be ready for the paladin to use this. Also, it puts them on Forbearance for 30 seconds, which prevents the use of Divine Shield. So if a paladin ever BOPs themselves, consider capitalizing on the fact that you can kill them before Forbearance is gone. Next, we've got Blessing of Freedom, which is simply a buff that removes all roots and snares while also making them immune to additional wounds. So you'll want to try an offensive dispel this whenever possible and reapply slows. You can also save stuns and other tools for reaching the paladin for during or after their freedom. One thing to note here is that red paladins can play with the talent Unbound Freedom, which will make the freedom undispellable on the paladin, while also having it apply to one of their teammates. But it can still be dispelled on their teammates, so play around that if needed. And the last blessing to look at is Blessing of Sacrifice. This redirects damage from whoever it's applied to back to the paladin, while also providing them with some damage reduction. And when paired with the ultimate sacrifice talent, holy paladins are able to make their target immune to damage while redirecting more of it to themselves. So whenever you see Blessing of Sacrifice used, consider swapping to the paladin in order to pressure them more. Next, we've got a handful of buffs that are specific to holy paladins in Divine Favor, Aura Mastery, and Divine Protection. First, Divine Favor has a 30-second cooldown and prevents the paladin from being interrupted. Classes with an offensive dispel will want to try and remove the Divine Favor in order to catch the paladin off guard and interrupt them. It's also worth noting, silences actually stop the Divine Favor cast. Things like Solar Beam or Silence from a Shadow Priest can be used to stop the heal, buying you ample time to remove it via an offensive dispel. Another tool that holy paladins have to prevent themselves from being interrupted is Aura Mastery. When paired with Concentration Aura, this allows paladins to prevent themselves from being interrupted. However, if they have Devotion Aura up, it will instead provide damage reduction, so keep an eye out for which aura the paladin has so that you know what benefits they're gaining from their Aura Mastery. And finally, holy paladins also have Divine Protection, which is another form of damage reduction that can be used while stunned. So whenever you see this buff applied, you may want to consider holding off on bursting them down. Next, let's take a look at a handful of buffs exclusive to Retribution Paladins. First, we have Seraphim, which is generally used just before a red sets up their burst. This costs 3 holy power and is almost always followed up by Avenging Wrath and Divine Toll, so you'll want to try and crowd control the red during Seraphim, or at least use it as an indicator that they're about to burst. Rets also have 3 defensive buffs in the form of Shield of Vengeance, Eye for an Eye, and Blessing of Sanctuary. Eye for an Eye has a 60-second cooldown and provides them with 30% physical damage reduction. This is only strong against non-Venthyr warriors and a handful of other melee. However, if you primarily deal magical damage, this won't really hurt you. Also, if you notice the red is playing with Eye for an Eye, that means the cooldown of their Divine Shield and Shield of Vengeance will be baseline, as it means they don't have the Unbreakable Spirit, which reduces the cooldown of Divine Shield as mentioned earlier, and Shield of Vengeance. And speaking of Shield of Vengeance, this is a red's most important defensive tool outside of Divine Shield. It provides them with an absorb that scales by their health and versatility. The shield also deals damage based on how much damage it absorbs, which can cause it to hit extremely hard in some cases. So you'll want to be aware of that fact, and either avoid being near the red when it either expires or is fully absorbed, or soak the absorb by having multiple players be around the red when it goes off. And last up, we have Blessing of Sanctuary, which a red can either use to remove crowd control from their teammates like silences, fears, or stuns, or they can preemptively use it to lower the duration of incoming set effects. To play around this, either cover the red when it's ready with cross CC to prevent them from using it, or if they use it and you still want to CC the target they applied it to further, make sure to offensively dispel the sanctuary before following up with any more CC that it would have otherwise reduced the duration of. And the final buff to look at for paladins is Reign of Endless Kings, which is actually a protection legendary that both rets and holy paladins can use. This gives them a huge amount of damage reduction when they drop to 20%, and if they have the Royal Decree Conduit, they also get a free Word of Glory. This is a little harder to play around, and your best bet is to try and burst the paladin down quickly before they hit 20% health. The next class we're taking a look at is priests. Starting with Disc, they've got a handful of defensive buffs for you to look out for. First, Rapture allows them to dish out huge power word shields, and even when an offensive dispel, you'll have a hard time trying Disc's teams through Rapture. The easiest way to handle this is to try and crowd control them during it. Pain Suppression is another defensive tool, this time one that can be used while the priest is stunned. There's 2 main ways to play around this. The first is to recognize when the priest becomes a great kill target, which is whenever Pain Suppression is on cooldown and the priest doesn't have a trinket. In these windows, you can switch to them with offensive cooldowns and quickly kill them. The second is the fact that they can't use Pain Suppression while interrupted on their Holy School, allowing you to make super aggressive plays such as interrupting a penance and trying to quickly burst down the priest. Next, Power Word Barrier provides the priest and his team damage reduction, which is increased by the PvP talent Dome of Light. You can identify if the priest is playing with what players call Big Dome by mousing over the buff to check what the damage reduction is. It's usually safe to assume though that the priest is playing with Dome of Light. As for dealing with this one, well, some classes can deny the dome with stuff like Ring of Peace and Death Grip, but if you can't get the priest out of the time, you'll just want to hold off on stunning and bursting until the dome is gone. Disc also has access to an offensive cooldown in the form of Dark Archangel, which they can apply to their entire team. This just provides them with a damage boost, so you'll want to be wary of an increased amount of damage coming in during their dark. And speaking of offensive cooldowns, Power Infusion is another one that all priest packs have. This gives their target 25% haste, but also with the Twins of the Sun Priestess, they're able to get Power Infusion on both themselves and a teammate. This buff can be offensively dispelled, so you'll want to try and remove it if possible, while also just being prepared to quickly trade defensive cooldowns when it's used on a target that can pair it up with strong offensive cooldowns, such as a Red Paladin or Fire Mage. Continuing with the trend of offensive priest cooldowns, let's take a look at Void Form, which is an offensive cooldown for Shadow Priests that's applied whenever they cast Void Eruption. This just gives them 20% increased shadow damage, while also giving them access to Void Bolt and the full benefit of their mastery, which they can use to deal even more damage. The key thing to note here is that priests will be dealing more damage during this window, so it's important for hybrids and healers to do things like Dispel Devouring Plague. Also, note that even if you interrupt Void Eruption, if the priest is playing Driven to Madness, he can still recast it straight away, so don't bother wasting your interrupts on this spell. Next we've got Greater Fade, which is a defensive tool that both Shadow Priests and Holy Priests have access to. This makes them immune to all spells, other than interrupts while it's up. So make sure you keep track of this buff to avoid letting priests immune your crowd control. And speaking of spells that priests can use to avoid crowd control, Holy also has access to Holy Ward, which they can apply to themselves or a teammate to immune crowd control. Once it immunes something, the buff fades, so you either want to CC it off or offensive dispel it if possible to get the priest into CC. This is yet another ability that's important to track, so you can avoid the priest immuning your CC. And the last priest spell to look at is another one exclusive to Holy Priests, Guardian Spirit. This one can also be applied to any member of the priest's team, and similar to Pain Suppression, can be used whilst the priest is stunned, and will provide them with a cheat death mechanic if the target is killed while it's up, bringing their health back up. It also increases the healing the target receives, so you'll want to try and keep the Holy Priest CC'd while it's up, and if possible, keep the target low until the Guardian Spirit expires before killing them. Up next, we've got warriors who have a handful of both offensive and defensive buffs that you need to look out for, some of which have quite obvious animations, but others are much more subtle. Starting with their offensives, Avatar removes slows and roots while also increasing their damage. This is usually paired with Warbreaker, which actually applies a debuff to those around a warrior. In order to handle these, this arm is generally the best tool. However, warriors will often look to follow their Warbreaker up with Bladestorm, which makes them immune to CC. So you'll need to be fast to CC a warrior on their offensives, while also always being ready to trade defensives if needed during these windows. Their other major offensive tool is Sharpened Blade, which again is actually a debuff the warrior applies to their target. Now, they can actually apply this to multiple targets with Sweeping Strikes if you stack up against the warrior, so you'll need to be mindful of when this happens and consider timing large heals outside of the Sharpened window. As for defensives, well, a warrior's defensive toolkit is quite large. Their biggest defensive cooldown is Die by the Sword, which is supposed to have a 2-minute cooldown. However, it's significantly reduced by the Stalwart Guardian Conduit, so just be wary of it being ready before it's supposed to be. As for dealing with it, well, besides the obvious forcing it and swapping, players with a disarm can actually prevent the warrior from using Die by the Sword if they disarm them before bursting them down. The same applies to stuns, as the warrior can't use Die by the Sword while stunned. And when it comes to actually swapping to warriors, you'll want to keep an eye on their defensive stance buff, which provides them with 20% damage reduction. But when they use battle stance, they lose that damage reduction and can't swap back for a few seconds, making them a prime target. Just note that warriors also have Ignore Pain, which they can use to help reduce the damage they take by giving themselves an absorb. Warriors also have Rallying Cry, which is reduced to a 2-minute cooldown with the Master and Commander PvP talent, and is made a super strong cooldown with the Inspiring Presence Conduit. Not much you can do here, except understand that it's a 2-minute cooldown that warriors can use to help keep their team alive, so don't overcommit for a kill when this is ready. On the flip side though, if you see the buff is fading and your target is low, pushing for a kill can be a great idea. Next we've got Spell Reflection, which warriors can apply to themselves to reflect a single spell. It can also be applied to a teammate with the Misshapen Mirror Legendary. The key here is that it only reflects one spell, so you'll want to make sure you keep track of this cooldown if you have important spells you want to avoid having the warrior reflect, and to make sure to remove it before trying to use something on the warrior. It's also off the global cooldown, which means the warrior can use it at any point, so just be careful with this one. Warriors can also use the Overwatch PvP talent to give their teammate a reflect with Intervene. So again, you'll want to keep an eye out for this and avoid getting your CC reflected at vital times if you notice the warrior is playing with Overwatch. And speaking of intervene, this will redirect all attacks to the warrior whenever they use it on a teammate. This is a big part of a warrior's team utility and the main reason why they're able to support their team so well. To handle this, make sure you're either cross-CCing the warrior when setting up kills on their teammates, or simply swapping to the warrior and directing all of your team's damage into them whenever they intervene. Just know that it's common for warriors to pair their intervene with die by the sword whenever you use offensive cooldowns, so don't be surprised when an entire offensive attempt is soaked up by the warrior. Warriors also have War Banner, which is yet another defensive tool they can use for dealing with crowd control on their team. This time, however, instead of reflecting it, it reduces the duration of all incoming CC by 50%. So you'll want to make sure you kill the War Banner before using your CC whenever possible. Finally, a PvP talent that is not commonly used these days is Duel. Instead of applying a buff though, this debuffs their target and causes both players to deal 50% less damage to other targets. So if you ever get dueled, you should probably consider switching to the warrior. Up next, we've got the ever-popular Mage. Starting with their offensives, each spec has access to a single offensive cooldown, each of which acts in a similar way, with Fire having Combustion, Frost having Icy Veins, and Arcane having Arcane Power. All three of these can be offensive dispelled, and all significantly increase the mage's damage, especially combustion. And while you won't quickly get taken down by a mage with icy veins and arcane power, it's still worth trying to offensively dispel them. However, combustion is a different story and must always be handled appropriately, usually with defensive cooldown trading. The tricky thing here is that combustion's cooldown can be lowered with a PvP talent pyrokinesis, so you'll want to keep an eye on how much a fire mage is casting fireball to get a feel for how much lower their combustion cooldown is, so that you're not caught completely off guard. As for their defensive tools, each spec again has a set of barriers that are made even stronger with their standard legendary triune ward. So whenever Blazing Barrier, Ice Barrier, or Prismatic Barrier is used, mages will gain a ton of absorb that either needs to be offensively dispelled or damaged through. To pair with this, they've also got Alter Time, which can be used as a pseudo-defensive cooldown. Mages will look to use this buff when they're high on health, and then use it again after dropping low to go back to the health they had when they used it. This can be offensively dispelled, and mages are also unable to reuse Alter Time while stunned, so a great strategy is to either offensively dispel the Alter while pressuring them, or stun them to prevent them from going back to full health. Alternatively, you can also just wait until Alter is gone to burst them down. Arcane mages also have the PvP talent Temporal Shield, which works by healing the mage for the damage they took while it was up. This can also be offensively dispelled and so can be treated just like Alter Time, but even if dispelled, will still heal the mage for the damage absorbed. In addition to these defensive tools, mages also have Ice Block, which provides them with an immunity. And while it does have a 4-minute cooldown, Frost mages can reset it with Cold Snap, and Fire mages have Cauterize as a cheat death mechanic, which has a 5-minute cooldown. And just like Divine Shield, Ice Block can be removed by Shattering Throw and Mass Dispel. Next we've got Rogues, who have a handful of powerful buffs. Offensively, sub-rogues being Shadow Dance and Shadow Blades, both of which play a huge part in the rogue's ability to set up kills. Shadow Dance alone is enough for rogues to deal significant burst damage, so keeping an eye on when this is used and immediately CCing the rogue whenever possible will make their life miserable. Sub-rogues also play with the talent Enveloping Shadows, which gives their dance an additional charge, making it difficult to track with omnibar, which means you need to be even more switched on and alert against sub-rogues. As for Shadow Blades, this is a longer cooldown but definitely allows the rogue to burst much faster as they'll be generating more combo points. So again, just be ready to trade defensives if a rogue is doing a clean setup with both blades and dance up. As for their defensive toolkit, well, both Cloak of Shadows and Evasion are their most potent buffs that essentially provide an immunity to spells and melee attacks respectively. With Cloak, there isn't much counterplay, other than the fact that it can't be used while stunned. However, it's important to note that the Prepared for All Conduit can lower the cooldown of Cloak, so don't be surprised if it's ready a little sooner than it usually is. As for Evasion, while this allows rogues to avoid melee attacks, if you're able to try and hit them from behind, your attacks will still go through. So try to play around this fact, especially when playing a melee cleave, as you'll be able to approach the rogue from two different directions to at least allow one of the melee on your team to hit them. In addition to these longer cooldowns, rogues also have Feint, which can be used to reduce the damage they take by 30% when they are specced into the elusiveness talent. The easiest way to play around this is to just keep an eye on when the rogue uses Feint, and try to time your stuns and damage around it. You can also get the rogue into CC before you set up on them to prevent them from pre-fainting the go. And for rogues that are not using elusiveness and are instead specced into cheat death, they'll likely survive the first kill on them if it procs at the right time. Just know that if they are playing cheat death, they'll have way less damage mitigation throughout the game, making them an excellent target to train. Next up, we've got monks. Both specs share a bunch of defensive cooldowns, including Fortifying Brew, Dampen Harm, and Diffuse Magic, all working in a similar way to reduce damage, with none of them being usable while the monk is stunned. Both Dampen Harm and Diffuse Magic are on the same talent row, which means a monk can never have both. So once you see one of them used, you'll know what defensive toolkit the monk has available to them in the game. And while Diffuse Magic is generally strong enough to prevent casters from killing the monk with magical damage, Dampen Harm is more of a cooldown the monk will just press to help alleviate some pressure, but you won't need to necessarily switch off of them. Windwalkers also have Touch of Karma as their major defensive cooldown. What's unique about this one though is that it's actually applied to their target as a way to redirect the damage they take. To handle this, you can either trade an immunity like Blessing of Protection and Ice Block to remove it, or you can just go through it by dealing a high amount of damage. The Mistweaver major defensive cooldown on the other hand is Life Cocoon, which they apply to a teammate as a large absorb. The main thing to keep an eye on here is that Chrysalis reduces the cooldown by 25 seconds, so make sure you're tracking it properly. Moving on to offensive buffs, Windwalkers have two huge ones in the form of Weapons of Order and Shwen. Weapons of Order is their Kyrian ability that provides them with a huge boost to their mastery, and more importantly, lasts 30 seconds, which can make it incredibly hard to deal with. The main thing to understand here is that you should only expect a ton of damage from the Windwalker Monk during their Weapons of Order window. The only exception to this is during their Shwen, which is generally also paired with Weapons of Order. Shwen hits really hard and also gives monks an increased amount of haste with their legendary of choice, Invoker's Delight, so you absolutely need to trade defensive cooldowns for it. Last up, we have a buff that both specs have access to, which is Tiger's Lust. What players often mistake here though is that Tiger's Lust is not actually a freedom effect, and instead it just removes roots and snares. This means you can in fact re-slow or root the monk after it's been used. The next class is another hybrid which also shares a bunch of buffs among every spec, while also having several spec-specific buffs you'll need to look out for. First, we've got a bunch of defensive buffs that every spec can apply, starting with Barkskin. This can be used while stunned, and simply gives druids a 20% damage reduction. There isn't much outplay here, and especially considering the short cooldown, it's difficult to try and make sure it's not ready when you set up kills. But it's good to understand when it's not ready to make your setups on druids and stunts more threatening. Another buff which is slightly more pivotal in a druid's ability to survive setups is Frenzied Regeneration. While this can be used manually by druids who play with Guardian Affinity, it's also automatically applied by druids who use the well-honed Instincts Conduit and the Natural Order's Will Legendary. In both cases, you just need to understand that the druid will have a decent amount of self-healing to help them survive the damage you use to drop them low. Another buff to look out for is Thorns, which deals damage to those who melee attack a target with the buff. This can be offensively dispelled, so you'll want to have your team either try to remove this or you'll usually be forced to swap if you can't afford to take a lot of damage. But if you're not under too much pressure, it can be fine to attack into the Thorns. Just make sure that if you decide to do this, you're doing it willingly because you're fine with taking the damage. Next, we've got a few offensive buffs, most notably Incarnation, which is often chosen by balanced druids. This makes their celestial alignment a stronger cooldown, causing them to deal a ton of damage, and is especially scary when paired with Convoke the Spirits by Night Fae balanced druids. A great trick is to check the balanced druid's team's buffs to see if they've applied kindred spirits to someone. If they have, then you'll know the druid is playing Kyrian, and you won't have to worry about a potential incarnation with Convoke. If you can't see the Kindred Spirits buff, then you'll most likely need to prepare for a Celestial Alignment or Incarnation that's paired with Convoke. Balanced druids can also innervate their healer, which can make a huge difference in longer dampening games, so you'll want to try and remove this where possible if you expect it to be a mana game. If you can't remove it, then CCing the healer during the innervate is a great play. As for Pharaohs, their major offensive cooldowns are Berserk and Tiger's Fury. While keeping track of Tiger's Fury isn't too easy, you should at the very least keep an eye on Berserk to know when the Feral is looking to play offensive and focus on dealing a lot of damage while setting up kills. It's also worth noting that Berserk, when combined with Tiger's Fury and a Feral's legendary of choice Eye of Fearful Symmetry, will allow Ferals to deal back-to-back ferocious bites that hit hard. So make sure you keep an eye out for these buffs and avoid dropping too low without using defensive cooldowns to survive the potential burst damage that can quickly take you out. As for defensives, Survival Instincts is a Pharaoh's most important cooldown. Unlike Barkskin, this one cannot be used while stunned. However, it offers a lot more damage reduction and has two stacks, meaning it's harder to keep track of with omnibar. So you'll need to make a mental note and just keep an eye for the number of times they've used this buff to better understand how many charges they have left to survive incoming damage. As for their HOTS, you generally want to try and avoid dealing damage into a target that's got full HOTS, especially if they have Life Bloom. Just know that even when you're swapping around or offensively dispelling HOTS to set up kills, Resto Druids have access to Overgrowth, which they can use to quickly get all of their HOTS up. And last up, we have Resto Druids who, besides the obvious HOTS they can apply, have Ironbark as a major defensive cooldown. You generally won't be able to kill targets through Ironbark, so it's important to try to prevent the Druid from being able to pre-Ironbark one of your setups. And if you can't do that, then just make sure to play around it by swapping. The last important buff to look out for with Resto Druids is Nature Swiftness. While you shouldn't expect to ever be able to purge the Nature Swiftness before the Druid can use it to top someone, you at least need to be aware of this cooldown, and the fact that Resto Druids can use it to heal someone to full if they're out of CC. So if Nature Swiftness is ready, either make sure you don't allow the Druid to get it off during a setup, or if you can't stop it, just don't overcommit for the kill. The last hybrid we'll be looking at are Shamans, who again have a bunch of buffs that are shared by all specs while also having several spec-specific buffs. Both Astro Shift and Grounding Totem are used by all three Shaman specs as a way to keep themselves alive. First, Astro Shift is a powerful damage reduction buff that cannot be used while stunned. It's for that reason you should look to keep the Shaman locked down during a kill attempt. And if they do manage to get their Astro Shift off, avoid committing too much for the kill, as the damage reduction is quite significant. As for Grounding Totem, this will cause any targeted spells to be immune, which makes it extremely important to track and play around, especially when trying to set up CC on the Shaman. Otherwise, you'll end up just letting the Shaman ground all of your crowd control, including things like Hammer of Justice whenever you try to CC them. So, you'll generally need to move towards the Shaman to bait the Grounding Totem before then being free to land your crowd control. On the offensive side of things, Sky Fury Totem is also available to all Shaman specs, but it's mostly just used by Elemental and Restoration Shamans. This makes their setups with the right classes very deadly, so it's extremely important to track Sky Fury and make sure to kill it as soon as it's used. If the Shaman places it in a good position, for example behind a pillar, be prepared to trade defensives if the Shaman's team paired a Sky Fury with other strong offensive cooldowns like an LA Stormkeeper or a Rest Avenging Wrath. And speaking of Stormkeeper, that's an Elemental Shaman's biggest offensive cooldown, and is especially scary when paired with an Echoing Shock Lava Burst. Elemental Shamans will usually cast Stormkeeper, use Sky Fury, then Echoing Shock into a Lava Burst, and Stormkeeper Lightning Bolt. This combination is very deadly and can easily kill you 100-0 if you're not ready for it. So you have to keep an eye out for when the Shaman gets Stormkeeper up while also being super vigilant to know when the Shaman uses Echoing Shock. The best way to deal with this is to make sure you dispel Flame Shock from the Elemental Shaman's target as soon as they get their Echoing Shock buff up. This will prevent them from bursting their target, as Echoing Shock will be consumed once they apply Flame Shock again. Otherwise, make sure you trade defensive cooldowns. Continuing on with offensive cooldowns, Enhancement Shamans have an abundance of them and generally pair them all together. Starting with Wind Fury Totem, this doesn't seem too scary, but because of their Doom Wind's legendary, it provides them with a crazy amount of burst. You'll want to keep an eye on the Shaman's buffs and debuffs to know when Doom Winds is up and when it's ready to be applied again, as they get a debuff while Doom Winds is on cooldown. Ascendance is then another massive cooldown that can allow Shamans to kill people in under a second if paired with Doom Winds. This has to be peeled immediately every time, or major defensives must be traded. And last up, we have Bloodlust or Heroism, which the Enhancement Shaman will use to increase both their own and a teammate's haste. This one is at least dispellable, so if your team has an offensive dispel, try to remove it when possible. The only buff left to keep an eye out for is Earthen Wall Totem. While this isn't the strongest cooldown, it can definitely play a huge part in the Resto Shaman's ability to keep themselves and their team alive. However, it's mostly good at preventing multiple small hits as opposed to large amount of damage, which means classes like Rets, Balanced Druids, and Fire Mages that have huge bursts can sometimes go through it. The final caster to look at is Warlock. All three specs share the defensive cooldowns Unending Resolve and Netherward, with the former being a damage reduction that can be used while stunned, which also provides an immunity to interrupts, while Netherward is a PvP talent that reflects all spells while it's up. With Unending Resolve, the long cooldown is how you effectively play around it, by looking to burst the Warlock down with offensives before it's ready again. However, the Conduit Resolute Barrier will reduce the CD of this, so once more, don't be surprised if a Warlock has his cooldown back faster than usual. As for Nether Ward, despite the fact that it reflects spells, it can in fact be offensively dispelled, so be wary of that fact and play around it. As for their offensives, Dark Soul is the primary one and it can be offensively dispelled, so you'll definitely want to do so when possible. Otherwise, if you find yourself up against a Warlock using Unending Resolve offensively to free cast during their Dark Soul and you cannot remove the Dark Soul, you'll need to trade defensive cooldowns to survive. Summon Dark Glare is yet another offensive, specifically for Affliction Warlocks. And while this one isn't a buff, it's still good to be aware of the increased damage an Affliction Warlock will be dealing after summoning Dark Glare. And last up, we have Havoc, which allows a Destro Warlock to coil two people. If you have a D curse on your team, you'll want to try and instantly dispel the Havoc to prevent the Warlock from coiling two people. Up next, we've got Hunters, who don't have too many important buffs to look out for, but the ones they do have are very powerful. First, a look at their offensives, with Marksmanship Hunters having True Shot and Survival Hunters having Coordinated Assault. While Coordinated Assault is a flat damage boost, True Shot works by allowing the Hunter to pump out a lot more damage in a shorter window, making it a very threatening offensive cooldown, especially when paired with the Kyrian ability Resonating Arrow, which allows Hunters to attack through line of sight and increases their crit chance. You'll absolutely need to trade defensives against Hunters that have these buffs up, but doing things like CCing them with Disarm or other forms of CC is also a great way to alleviate some pressure during these windows. Beyond those offensives, Hunters have a handful of defensive buffs that greatly assist in their survival, the most important of which is Roar of Sacrifice as it prevents crits, which usually helps whoever it's applied to survive. One thing to note though is that Roar of Sacrifice redirects damage to the Hunter's pet, which can make the pet easier to kill during these windows, and as you might know, a Hunter without their pet is a lot easier to deal with. More often than not, if you manage to kill their pet and are able to stop the resummon, you'll force their only major defensive cooldown aspect of the turtle, in order for them to channel the long interruptible cast of Revive Pet. Do this once more and you'll likely win the game. Another important buff to look out for is applied whenever the Hunter uses Feign Death with the Survival Tactics PvP talent, as it applies a huge absorb for 1.5 seconds whenever it's used. Just avoid dealing damage into the Hunter after they feign with this PvP talent. And the last Hunter ability to look at is Master's Call, which works just like a Paladin's Blessing of Freedom by making the target immune to slows and roots while it's up. A great way to handle training Hunters, especially marksmanship ones, is to stun them during their Master's Call. This will make it incredibly hard for them to kite you. Moving on, let's take a look at all the important buffs that Death Knights bring to the table. First, we've got a handful of defensive cooldowns that every DK spec shares in the form of Icebound Fortitude, Anti-Magic Shell, Anti-Magic Zone, and even Lichborn. First, IBF works as a power damage reduction cooldown that also breaks the DK out of stuns. What's vital to know here is that the Conduit Chilled Resilience reduces the cooldown of this spell. So again, much like Die by the Sword for Warriors, you'll need to be aware of this CD being ready sooner than normal. Next, Anti-Magic Shell works as a magic absorb on a relatively short cooldown. While this is initially quite potent in the early game, this cooldown becomes much weaker as dampening gets higher, which makes DKs a lot easier to kill for players that primarily deal magical damage in damage. As for Anti-Magic Zone, this was made baseline for DKs in Shadowlands and reduces magical damage taken by 20%. DKs can spec into Dome of Ancient Shadow to make AMZ become what feels almost like an immunity to magical damage, but they do so at the cost of other important PvP talents. So, much like with the Power Word Barrier from this priest, simply mouse over the first AMZ a DK uses to check what percentage it's reducing magical damage by to know if it's actually a huge cooldown or not. Another important buff, or rather debuff, to look out for is Dark Simulacrum. While this isn't played with often these days, it can be quite annoying to deal with if you're not aware of it. Essentially, when applied to the DK's target, it will steal the next spell they cast which costs mana, allowing the DK to steal anything from Polymorph to Divine Shield. So you'll definitely want to track this and avoid letting a DK steal important spells once you have identified that they're playing with it. Last up, let's cover the offensive DK buffs. Frost DKs have two, in the form of Pillar of Frost and Empower Rune Weapon. You'll mostly just want to keep an eye out for Pillar of Frost, which will work in conjunction with the Obliteration talent to give Frost DKs a ton of damage during their Pillar with Obliterate crits. So definitely respect this cooldown. Also, during this time, you can expect the DK to try and set up an AoE kill attempt with Chillstreak. And while Chillstreak isn't a buff or debuff you can directly see, you'll also want to keep track of this with Omnibar or a weak aura, so that you can play around it by rotating trinkets and trading defensives to avoid the damage. It's worth noting, Shamans can also ground this effect. As for Unholy DKs, they have Unholy Assault, Dark Transformation, and Raise Abomination. Unholy DKs aren't too strong right now though, so you won't have too much to worry about. Regardless, you'll generally see these spells all used together at the same time to create windows of high pressure. Still, killing the DK's Dark Transform pet and Abomination is certainly a viable strategy. Otherwise, trading CDs is just fine as their pressure outside of these windows isn't too great. The last class we're gonna take a look at are Demon Hunters. While they don't have many buffs that you need to keep an eye out for, they have a handful of important ones that you need to interact with in different ways. First, Blur provides them with a dodge chance that works no matter the direction you attack them in. So unlike a rogue's evasion, they can dodge even if you attack them from behind, meaning you'll need to stun them if you want to melee through Blur. Darkness is then their strongest defensive cooldown, and it works by reducing the chance your abilities will hit them. What's important here is that a Demon Hunter needs to use the PvP talent Cover of Darkness to make their darkness a reliable defensive cooldown. And much like with Power Word Barrier and Anti-Magic Zone like we mentioned earlier, you'll just need to mouse over the icon to tell if they're using it or not by looking at the percentage chance that your attacks will miss. In addition, most Demon Hunters also use the legendary Darkest Hour, which gives them an additional darkness when they drop low. There's not much counterplay here, other than again to check if they're using Cover of Darkness or not by mousing over it when it procs, assuming you haven't already seen a darkness use in that game. The main thing to understand here is that these two darkness uses are treated separately, which means the DH effectively has two separate darkness abilities to keep themselves and potentially their team alive. Metamorphosis is then their major offensive cooldown that significantly increases their damage and is especially potent if you allow the Demon Hunter to channel a full I-beam, as they will get a 15% haste buff whenever they do. So make sure to interrupt I-beam where possible and be prepared for an onslaught of damage whenever you can't. The last Demon Hunter ability to look at is Spectral Sight, which simply lets them see enemy players in stealth. The key here is that their Spectral Sight breaks if you can hit them, so if you're playing Rogue Mage Priest or any comp that relies on a stealth opener, try to hit the Demon Hunter to prevent them from getting your Rogue out of stealth, or have your Rogue attempt to outplay the Demon Hunter by lining and going for a sap at the right moment. Alright guys, hopefully you picked up a few things that you previously didn't know and have now taken another step closer to becoming a better player. That about does it for this one. If you enjoyed the video, please like the video and be sure to subscribe and hit the bell to be notified the moment we release more awesome Shadowlands PvP content like this. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you next time.